So, just a little bit of background about me. I live in Worcester, and Worcester is infamous for being flooded. As you can see here, there's Worcester with swans in the street and car park shut, and the car at the far back end of the car park didn't listen to the flood warning and got flooded. So I didn't honestly expect a flood because I don't live or didn't live on an official floodplain. So this is my street. Went shortly after I'd moved in on just a normal grey English day. And that was it after not very much longer raining. And that was it a few hours later. And the background to my story is that every time it rained, winter, spring, summer or autumn, our street would flood. And Severn Trent Water said it was because the river flooded. But the river wasn't in flood 9 times out of 10 when we flooded. So we felt enough was enough and took them on. But one thing I've always learnt is I do not go finger jabbing at people. I don't shout, I don't get angry at those that manage flood risk. I'm extremely nice. And when Severn Trent came to visit my home, I did apologise for lack of carpets and made them some coffee and chocolate biscuits and got a good practical working relationship with them. I made them like me so we could work in partnership, and they went out of their way to help and solve the solution rather than back away, because a lot of people, when they get angry and they finger jab and they jump up and down and shout, those that manage flood risk do back off rather than wanting to work with you. So that's always been an ethos of mine, to be as nice as possible. So this is my home, and the first flood, my son in the middle, had actually yelled up, I've been flooded 12 times by the way, yelled upstairs, "Mum, my bedroom," we were doing the house up, "my bedroom's full of flood water and it stinks." And then we found other people's toilet paper. I don't use blue toilet paper in my house. And the one at the picture with the plaster knocked off was in between two floods. They'd knocked the plaster off for me because I had a disabled child and we couldn't move out because of his needs. And we moved upstairs, and the floods came back again, so it took a lot longer to repair. So can I ask how many of you here have actually been flooded? So I'm going to say sorry to you now, because this is something I do and I want you just to see what I do. I actually go around the country telling people what it's like to flood. So if you want to put your fingers in your ears, shut your eyes, that's fine, because I know it's very painful for you. But I have to do it. I literally have to do it, and I've been doing this for 16 years now. But this is something I'm sure you all agree with, those of you that's been flooded. To us, we're a newspaper column. We're a column in a newspaper, and a radio station's 5 minutes or a few hours. But to us, we've lost our lives as we knew them. And it's not about being flooded as such. It's the recovery of being flooded that knocks people for six so badly. And floods have the capacity to knock out whole communities. And this is a community in Gloucestershire, where every house was flooded, the pub, the school, the community hall, everything was flooded. And actually rebuilding a community that's reeling can be very, very difficult indeed. And these are people, friends that I've made across the years, have given me these photographs, and they hit home so strongly as to just how awful it is to be flooded. And this was a friend of mine's kitchen. And you that have been through it, you do know flood water isn't nice, is it? It's a dark brown and it smells very badly. And also, this is another house, a house in Buckinghamshire. And the night before, you know, we go to bed and there are our homes, our sanctuary, everywhere that we hold dear, completely annihilated. And when we go home from here today, we go home, we pass our feet up, we have a cup of coffee, we are completely enveloped in our own security, our own sanctuary. And when you're being flooded, you lose that. And this again is somebody's home and being actually rescued. I've talked to people about the trauma they go through when they're rescued in such situation, when you've got the fire and rescue up to their over their waists in water, and you have to get out, perhaps in the dark, into a boat. It's incredibly stressful. And of course, these are familiar sights to you all in Carlisle, but they are the inside of people's homes. They are people's stuff. People have saved up for that. I lost playgroup drawings. I lost my memories. I lost photographs. Everything that your memory bank. And in fact, I was taking part in something this week about posting things that are special to you on a Facebook page. And I couldn't put lots up because I've lost so much of it. And I'm sure those of you that have been flooded feel exactly the same. And then this is a caravan. And I know somebody yelled at me, do I live up there? Did he live up there for an hour? But that was the caravan for a year. That was the caravan being delivered. And a friend of mine lived in that caravan for 2 whole years in 2007 when her home was flooded, along with 55,000 other homes. And of course, you all know this. These are you know what these are like. This is when the minister and the media have gone. This is the inside of people's homes. This is the reality, the harshness of it all. And that's when people start to hit a really low spot. Because when the flood's there, you're full of sort of bonhomie and a bit like the war effort, and you all rally together. And it's a sort of a good time, even though it's awful, it's good. But actually, the next months, the months when your home is annihilated, it's taken to pieces, and you have to live with that. So you're going to work, but at the same time, you're project managing a building site that is your own home. And I spoke to somebody in Tunbridge, and she said that she'd had 30 telephone calls during the day from the plumber, the electrician, the loss adjuster, etc., while she was trying to hold down her job, to the extent that her boss actually took her aside and said, look, you're not delivering. So that's another fallout of being flooded. And after the flood as well, come the sharks and the cowboys and people that can say that they'll put your house back for cash and not the VAT, and people knocking the door to say they can do this, that and the other. And that's another thing that if you've not been flooded before that you have to deal with. So I have written, as part of the Know Your Flood Risk campaign, a guide to flood recovery, along with a very talented PhD student that I use, who has also been flooded. And what we did is we took the best of of all the flood recovery advice that was out there and added our own personal hints and tips, and using our knowledge base of what we'd experienced. So I commend that to you. But one thing that I do find deeply worrying is that 2/3 of households do not check their flood risk before they buy a property. Now, with the North East, 88%, these are relatively new stats, 88% of people in the North East do not check their flood risk when they're buying a home. Now, when you're buying a home, you get loads of paperwork like this, don't you? And in amongst that will be your flood report. Now, I think that solicitors are morally obliged to tell you that you're at risk of flooding and do know what you're doing and give you some advice. So I've done a lot of webinar training of solicitors to actually encourage them and give them the tools they need to support people that are maybe buying a house that is set to flood. And you can actually buy a desktop report, £25. I bought one when I moved house, and I think it was the best because it drills down to your doorstep level, and it's the best £25 I spent when I was moving house. And I sort of talk you through now, and I'm sure those of you have been flooded, that preparation is half the battle. Where are you going to put your car? You don't want your car flooded as well as your home. Where are you going to put Grandma Zimmer frame, your pet hamster, the children? Where are you going to put your precious stuff? And actually have it written down, because when that flood warning comes, again, you know the feeling, your heart goes into overdrive, your mind goes balmy. And if you've got something written down, you can actually work through it in a sensible way. I was in a house once with a woman that got a flood warning, and she started emptying her cupboards up here rather than down here. And it's things like that, that actually having that written support, you can download that from my own website. It's marydonough.co.uk. Now, this great guy here, I believe he was the first person to be aware of flooding and he actually took action. I don't think perhaps we're at the ARC stage yet, but with the threat of climate change, maybe we'll all have one of those on our drive soon. I'm not going to bang on about Environment Agency flood warnings, and I hope those of you that are at risk of flooding are signed up, because it does give you time to move your stuff and do and exercise your family flood plan. And if you don't qualify for an agency flood warning, there are a lot of telemetry systems about that can give you a warning, and they can be based in a brook and placed strategically, so they can ring you all up to let you know that you might get a flood that's imminent. Now, quite often, flood defences are just not enough. I've put the Albert Hall up there because in parts of Cumbria last year, enough rain fell in 1 minute to fill the Albert Hall from top to bottom. Now, you can manage that, but you can't stop it. There's not one fix for flooding. It's a little bit of a lot. It's a bit like, I call it Mary's jigsaw puzzle, that you actually piece it together. And obviously some of that will be land management and agricultural management and land storage and natural flood management and hard engineered defences and temporary defences. But all sorts of things, not just one thing. And we shouldn't all focus on one thing that's going to prevent it. It's a lots and lots of different things put together that will help reduce and manage risk. And we've seen flood alleviation schemes overtopped. And we've also seen robust, really robust defences in Keswick that you can see how badly they were hit. We've seen them overtopped. So we know the sheer volume of rain that falls can wreak havoc. And that's why I believe quite passionately in a personal resilience at property level. Something that you can control and take ownership of yourself. Now, I'm going to say this, I hate sandbags, I absolutely hate them. We all call out for sandbags in a flood, but if you hold water up to a sandbag, it will go straight through it, and you can see a perfect picture of it here, not working. Bear with me a moment. And then we've got, this was, I know people in Somerset really quite well, and I've become very friendly with them. In fact, one of them, my friends in Somerset, is on Country File in a couple of weeks, and I set up that interview for her. I'm not on it because I'm here today. So they are filming this today and tomorrow and Monday. This is a huge pile of sandbags that my friends in Somerset, they were calling like mad for sandbags, and they've told me they never want to see another sandbag again. Simon, you may recognise this one. Sandbags, I've got a very clever guy at the back, worked out for me that a metre of sandbags cost £231 to dispose of. And some temporary defences can be £205 per metre. So there's spot the difference in that. There is a disparity in the cost. And also, the best thing about the temporary defences is that they can be used again. So to me, it's a no-brainer to be go stacking up that when you think of the manpower that goes into sandbags, and they've got to be put into a landfill, and they have to pay a landfill tax. So this is really the next step forward, and that's what we exhibited today. There are lots and lots of kite mark property level products that you'll find, and the reason I like these is because you can see that they're working. I like proof of stuff working. The bottom left hand, it's not terribly clear, but there's a pair of red shoes there, and there's flood water up against it. And I keep saying to people, or the product manufacturers, to send me photographs to actually convince people that these products actually do work, and they're an awful lot better than sandbags. And incidentally, I have no financial interest whatsoever in any flood protection company. And this is another one here, and I love this picture because you can see the sandbags not working, and you can see that the product is working. So, you know, what's not to like, really? And this is another example of one working in along the Thames in 2014. Also, an awful lot of water can get into your home just by the air bricks alone. And quite often people will say that the first thing they knew that were flooded was because it came through the carpets, and it would be because it's coming through the air bricks. And there are a few self-closing air bricks on the market. Always look for a kite mark, because you know that they've been tested to government standards. And there are lots of other gizmos here, such as pan seals and toilet bungs and anti-backflow valves to stop things getting from your washing machine. And also, really, non-return valves, absolutely essential. I didn't have one, and that's why I had other people's toilet roll in my house. But actually, when the flood water hits a non-return valve, it will stop that kind of thing, sewage coming into your home. And also here, we've got self-rising barriers. You've seen them in the type in Cockermouth. You can actually get them at domestic level that will people prefer to keep water away from their home. So there's a variety here, if you've got the money, of self-rising barriers. That's in its closed position, and that's it up. And again, there are companies here today that can provide those. And this is a very simple solution. That this bungalow, the person in this bungalow, had rung me several times to say that she'd been flooded, and all it was overland runoff, really. And something simple like that was stopped the flood water from getting into her house. And the people that sell that are here today. It can be strategically stored in the community, and the community can, if the powers that be can't get to put them up, they can put things like that up. And communities can work together to manage this. And this one is a water gate. I've got many, many pictures of this one that works. And again, people, it can be put in the back of somebody's estate car. It can fold up to practically nothing, housed in your garage. The minute you know you're going to stop, you can put it up, you can erect it, and it will stop water from coming into your home. And not just one home, it can be several of you that band together. So that's a really good example. Now, I'll say a little bit about floodery. Have out of interest, have any of you here got floodery, gone into floodery, or had your flood insurance got been put into floodery? Because, oh, good. You haven't got it yet. Well, I'll talk to you afterwards, because floodery, I mean, not before floodery, it's almost coming up for a year now. We say 23 years, it's 22 years and about 3 months now that it's going backwards. So people at high risk of flooding can get floodery, and you can see that 50% of the homes now at high risk have been protected with floodery. And the average saving is about £500 per premium. And I believe the insurance industry now need to start working towards rewarding people for getting flood resilience, either property level products or adapting their homes. And I'll talk a bit more about that. So actually, your premiums, you pay a risk reflected price, because when floodery finishes, we've got to be in the position to be able to afford flood insurance. And the only way we can do that at property level is to have thought about protecting our own homes. This, in the Know Your Home, Know Your Flood Risk on their website, I've designed with an excellent graphic designer that I stumbled across, a prototype of a flood resilient house. Now, I'm not going to go through every single bit of it, but it's really combined. It's keeping the water out and adapting it so it does little damage. And now, if you go onto the knowyourfloodrisk.co.uk website, you will see that. And you'll be able to look at it more closely. And I put quite a lot of work and thought into that, so I commend it to you. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit now about some case studies of people that have adapted their homes to make them flood resilient. I was filming with BBC Look North in Cockermouth, and a guy there came out of his house to say, "We were flooded to the depths of 7 foot 10 days ago. Come in my house." And okay, he'd made his bit bohemian, and he'd made his own homemade marie ply kitchen, But his Christmas decorations were up. He was back downstairs. He'd got a dehumidifier going, but he hadn't lost anything. He hadn't suffered any damage. And he was absolutely laid back and full of the joys of spring for himself. Now, this is the house of somebody actually who works in the flood protection industry. And he's a member, he was former chairman of the Property Care Association, Flood Protection Group. And he has two homes right on the banks of the river on Boxing Day. And they were both flooded, his home and his mother's home. And he'd got property level protection up, but it had been overtopped. And he said never again, not am I going through this. And I went to visit him when he still was in a recovery stage, but he was adapting his home, so if flood water got in, it didn't do its worst. And there are some examples here. He's got something that wooden floor is called AquaStep, and it can withhold being flooded, but he's also very anal. He's numbered every single piece of that flooring, so he can take it up. If he gets a flood warning, he can quite easily remove that flooring. He's, because of the build of the house, he's been able to put up higher property level protection. And he's got cavity wall membranes and a pumping system. So if the water gets in, it is automatically pumped out and it stays behind the wall. If you can imagine the membrane system coming down, then the plaster and your paint and things, the flood water comes into the house and is pumped out. And I've got pictures of it actually working and the home later on. And this is Sue. I'm sure a lot of you know Sue Cashmore in Cockermouth. Sue has been flooded on many occasions and she didn't have flood insurance last time. I'm very pleased to say that door, the kite mark door there, I managed to get for her for nothing. But she'd had already done some flood resilience, so her plaster was, she had 7 foot of water in her house. Her plaster didn't need knocking off, but she decided to sort of, because again, she had 7 foot of water, she's gone the whole hog resilience, and all her kitchen is freestanding, her boiler's upstairs, her electrics are isolated, the walls completely tiled from floor to ceiling, and she's got ceramic tiled floors. And so the plan is that if she gets flooded again, she will get some help, take everything upstairs, and then hose it down, sanitise it and carry on. So maybe you think that's a pipe dream. I'll tell you that it's not in a bit. This house in Kendal, this is a shop, combined shop and house. It had a lot of flood water. And he actually knocked all the plaster off and found that he'd got lovely walls that is in very much in keeping with the place there, and he's lime mortared it and replaced the stairs, built his own stairs, and he's got a bit of an alternative kitchen, and part of that he found lying on the riverbank, so he actually did reuse and recycle lots of things, and it didn't actually cost him much because he managed to find the ends of lines of absolutely everything. Now, this is the house that I did mention. This is the cavity wall membrane actually working. You can see the flood in the middle. And his children, it's not a brilliant picture, but his children are playing indoors while all this is happening. And it's a cottage in Oxford. And so he's done exactly the same as the guy in Leeds. And there it is in flood real time. And this one is, I think I showed you his kitchen in flood. It was a marine ply kitchen, and it's a lovely shaker style kitchen, but it has been under several feet of water. And he's got sacrificial carpets, tiles, he pulls them up. If he can get them up, that's fine, but if he can't, he doesn't. He's got the sump pumps. And also, he's a married couple, but his wife is disabled, and that's a very heavy bit of furniture. And he puts it onto bricks in polythene bags using a plank. He literally just plank lifts it, shoved the bricks underneath, and has moved it up. So that didn't really incur any expense, but it was just a practical way of moving things up when you do it by yourself. And that this couple in Gloucester that I went to talk to, they flood quite deeply, and they put their furniture on one of these stands. They've got them in the garage and they put their furniture straight up, And even they've got a double-decker hen house for their hens to go in. So if you've got hens and you need to put them upstairs, you can do that. And they float everything that's outside in buckets with lids on. And they know that there's robust buckets that they can get them back afterwards. And this is a Yorkshire property. And he just, in the end, he got so fed up of being flooded in his basement kitchen. A lot of houses around here have basements, don't they? And he just abandoned the kitchen and moved upstairs. He made it flood resilient downstairs. So when it came, he said it really was brilliant. That's a puddle sucker. And he set the puddle sucker on it and it goes right down to minimal level. And he's got his boiler up the wall. And he just said, you know, he hosed down and got on with it. Now, this really is my favourite of all the flood resilient case studies. A lovely, lovely couple, retired couple, on the banks of the Ouse in York. And they bought their property knowing it would flood. They bought with their heart and thought they'd deal with it. So this, when I walked in, I was sent by York City Council. I thought, why have they sent me here? There's nothing remarkable about this, nothing flood resilient. And that was the best bit about it. It was remarkable flood resilience, because the flooring that you can see bottom left, I thought it was wood. It's ceramic tiles. Their living room, ceramic tiles. Ceramic tiles have come on so much that you wouldn't know you'd got ceramic tiles. And that kitchen, they can, when they get the flood warning, they've got plans, they can dismantle the kitchen and take everything out. And all that remains is a granite working surface. And they have told me, I think I've got some more pictures of them, that, this is the lovely couple. They've got a flood store up a load of stairs. And you can see they've also got stands and they keep everything that they need up there. They've got their washing machine and dryers on plinths with baskets underneath, and they say as they're getting older it's so much better for them not having to bend down all the time, and they keep all their sort of cleaning stuffs up high as well. And they literally, I recorded the interview, and he said when a flood has happened, he hoses down, she sanitizes, they put the dehumidifiers out, and they're back to normal in an hour. So they say they've been flooded 10 times, that for them they have chosen to live in York overlooking the river because they love it. They've accepted that risk, they've adapted their home, they're in their 70s and they're very pleased with their lot. So where can you get, I'm going to finish now with a bit of information, the Know Your Flood Risk Guide, Homeowner's Guide to Resilience is on the Know Your Flood Risk website. It has the house in it. It has every flood protection product that's on the market. We talk about it. We've got all the case studies and more that I've talked about today. So I commend that to you. My own website, marydonough.co.uk, has got some hints and tips and photographs and things on. And then the National Flood Forum Blue Pages. I have to say to you, it's only a directory. So there's no guarantee of quality in the directory. It's up for you to actually do the research. So coupled with the homeowner's guide, you'll be able to fathom out what's good and what's not good. And I chair the Property Care Association Flood Protection Group. Now, it's a very established trade body of all things wet. They do they do flood resilient repair, and they treat wet, rotten, dry, what they do everything within the home. So it's a natural place for the flood protection group to sit. The application process is very stringent, and they turn away as many people as they accept, and they do help and support those people who haven't exceeded, that haven't complied with their exacting standards. They help them to actually raise the game, and they're in the middle now of actually running courses, and I'm taking part of the training on for surveyors that are looking into properties and how to protect the properties and all the things that they need to think about when they're protecting a property from flooding. So we're running courses like that. And so I commend their flood protection group to you if you're looking for an honest broker, because you know they've already been vetted. They're also backed by a government trust mark. So and to actually get a trust mark is really quite something. And also, as a member of the Property Care Association, I and the Chief Executive are taking part in the development of this. I'm on two or three subcommittees, and it's called the Property Flood Resilience Action Plan. It was put together by government and multi-agencies, and they're quite determined to raise standards within the industry. And there are a lot of subgroups, and we're all working frantically together to deliver the action plan. And the Property Care Association, and myself in particular, are very much in the heart of that. And I'll finish now with that picture. Somebody gave me that picture. It may look very, very beautiful, a couple of swans, but not when they're looking in your sitting room window like that. So thank you very much for coming and for your time this morning. And again, I apologise, I think my voice is just about holding out.